Hello and welcome to this very special session by the UPS School of Modern Media on fake news and fact-checking and busting fake news. My name is Nalin Mehta. I'm the Dean of the school. This session has specially been organized actually on, there's a lot of demand when we're talking to students through the year. So a lot of people were interested in fake news. A lot of people were interested in fact-checking. So we have a very special panel here today. We have Jensi Jacob, the Managing Editor of Boom Life, one of the pioneers in the fact-checking business, if I can call it that, in India, who basically set up Boom Live a while ago. We have Geetika Rustogi, who's content lead at To The New, former teaching fellow at Google News Labs, and who's done trainings on fake news and fact-checking, I think, in multiple newsrooms across India. I think more than 3,000 journalists, you've trained Geetika on various aspects. So a really stellar panel, and I think we're looking forward to a great conversation on aspects of fake news, fact-checking, and the kind of things that people who consume news should be aware of outside of what professionals like what Jensi and Geetika do. So I thought what we do is, in terms of setting the context, Jensi and Geetika, is that we thought that to set the context, we can start off with Geetika, essentially to lay out fake news and fact-checking 101, if you like, to sort of lay out the key concepts, some of the tools that are used, and some of the key misperceptions that we often deal with for about 10 minutes. And then we open it up for a freewheeling chat between us and with those who are joining us to discuss this whole thing. So Geetika, over to you.
Thanks. I will just start off with, I'll just share my screen and then I can, So can you see the slides?
Yes, we can, Geetika.
So just to give a little brief about how I end up learning fact-checking tools. Basically, in 2018, Google News Initiative announced this training bootcamp for fact-checking. They were going to select a handful of journalists and academicians from across the country and train them in set of tools which can be used for photo, video, and location, geolocation verification. So I got selected among some 240 other academicians and journalists. It was a great chance to get out of the newsroom because you don't get time to upskill yourself when you are in full-time news industry. So that's how it started. In 2018, this whole initiative called the Google India Training Network started. Google News Initiative India Training Network started. The network has trained about 240 fact-checking who have gone ahead and done more such trainings across the country. I think they have trained close to about 30,000 people or maybe more till now. Now, how did I, people must be wondering, I'm a content lead and what am I doing? But I do have a background in journalism, especially in social media and digital journalism. I worked as a journalist. I worked as a digital journalist all through the 10 years of my career. From last 1.5 years, I've been working as a content lead. After 2018, when I got my training, I also got the opportunity to do a fellowship with the Google News Initiative, which is basically, they take out working journalists from newsrooms and train them in certain digital tools that Google has for newsrooms and journalists. So I was their India teaching fellow. They have similar positions across the globe. And various. I trained about 3,000 journalists myself. I was traveling across the country, visiting media schools and newsrooms, be it national dailies or regional papers. I have trained at many places. It was about data journalism, search. How to do effective search, YouTube fact checking, data journal, representation of data, simple visualization tools, and a lot more. So that was like fun 12 months. And that's how I end up, getting more acquainted with the problem of fake news and, you know, tools and why, and tools of detecting and verifying fake news. So that's how I got into it. So I'll just quickly get into my presentation. It's a shorter, crisp one. So this is a photograph from our first boot camp that happened at Google office in Gurgaon. So just to, there's a little quiz. It's nothing too serious or anything, but it's a math quiz. You can give the answer in the comments below. So my question is, what is wrong with this image? If anybody has any answers, please feel free to put them in the comments below. Anyone like to take a...
There are answers coming in the chat box, if you can see, Githika.
Oh, yes.
And they actually, they're like, okay, they're just doubling up by the second. So people are saying 16, number 16 is missing. People are saying 14, after 14, there should be 16. A lot of people are saying 16 is missing. That's the most common one. Difference between 14 and 18 is 4. Somebody's saying table is wrong. Somebody's saying number 16 after 14, and so on and so forth.
Okay, fine. So those are some answers, but the mistake in this is that this is repeating. And or when I mentioned that it's a mathematical quiz, everybody just started looking at the numbers, right? This is exactly how fake news problem starts. You know, the context is always the problem there. Image in a, you know, a video can be real, you know, it can be of an actual event, but the context with which it's being shared can be misleading. And that's how I misled you, thinking that it's actually a number problem. This was nothing but just a, you know, not even a number problem, but this was just repeating in this sentence. So how, like, when did, like, what was the tipping point for fake news in India? So this was the video that I'm sure a lot of fact checkers must have seen by now. But for the uninitiated, this was the video which went viral sometime in 2018, claiming to be that, kidnapping kids in a city is very easy. You need to take care of your kids. Don't let them play outside, etc. It's a small video. I'll just quickly play it and tell you what actually aggravated things on ground. So this is just a video of, you know, kids playing and these... two guys come on a bike and they lift a kid and they go. And these kids are like, what happened? So this video got circulated with a context that, you know, this is how kids are being kidnapped nowadays. And a lot of people were actually lynched and killed on ground in various cities because of these rumors which started going on WhatsApp. This was actually one of the incidents that forced platforms to take some steps to fight against fake news and how they can control the spread of fake news on their platforms. The real story behind this is that it's actually a PSA, it's a public service ad from a Pakistan-based NGO called Roshni, which actually, this is not the whole video. There is 10 more seconds to this video where those guys come back to the same spot, put down the kid and hold up a banner saying that it takes less than a minute to kidnap a kid in Karachi. And this video still, but nobody knew the second part of the video about the, you know, Karachi and everything. That information was never passed on to when the rumors were being spread. And that is how it begins. So this is a genuine video, not a genuine, but yeah, this is a real actual footage. But again, it was being clipped and shared with a very different context. So what are different types of misinformation and disinformation. We don't generally call it just fake news because fake news is just one of it. There are about seven types of mis and disinformation, but let's just learn what's the difference between mis and disinformation. So misinformation is information that is false, but the person who's spreading it or sharing it or, you know, disseminating believes that it's right. It can happen with you and me who, you know, maybe some, you know, some, when your relatives send you something on WhatsApp, assuming that it's right. But disinformation is that information which is false and the person who's disseminating that it's wrong and they're still doing it. They're still sharing it because they have a hidden agenda. Maybe they want to deliberately cause damage to any community. They want to malign someone. They want to, you know, cause disharmony in society or whatever it is. They are doing it knowingly. So that's where the major difference comes. It sometimes gets really hard to make out the difference between misinformation and disinformation. So these are the seven types of misinformation, mis and disinformation. We have seen satirical and parody accounts in social media. The intention is not to cause any kind of harm. It's all for fun. Misleading content is basically using, you know, misleading information to frame an individual and organization. Imposter content is when I'm impersonating a source or a personality, organization, like setting up a Twitter account of, let's say, Narendra Modi's official account of PM Modi. Fabricated content, which is 100% fake content, which has been designed to deceive and cause harm. Like I could be creating a poster here and using Photoshop and giving out all sorts of information, misleading information. Now, false connection is when the headlines or visuals or captions don't support the content. It happens sometimes, like, you know, I could say that I'm standing in front of Taj Mahal. That's the picture, but I say that my post says that I'm standing at Red Fort. So that's kind of a false connection. False context is when genuine content is shared with false contextual information. This happens a lot in case of natural calamities or riots or, accidents, etc. Sometimes videos and pictures from old events start repurposing when a particular event happens, saying that these images are from that particular incident. It's a very thin line between false connection and false context. Content is when genuine information or imagery is manipulated to deceive people. So it can be a little confusing when you first look at it, but this is the broad category. And as I said, fake news is just one.
If I may at this point, just on the categories that you were saying, you know, when at the Times of India, when we started a fact check desk and we did it in seven different languages, one of the things that we were at pains to sort of put out and would love to get Gen Z also on this was that look, difference between bad, look, fact checking ultimately is about good journalism, right? But also there's a difference between fake news and just bad journalism. That's in the sense that, to put it very simply, I could be reporting, typically when there's an accident, say, right? There's a typical 101 example in crime reporting that five people see an accident, typically all five accounts may not necessarily match. They might have different accounts of it. Somebody writes a story on it and they make a genuine mistake of take of different perspective and so on, and which may not match with the actual fact as it may have happened. That's not fake news. That may be journalism, that may be just bad journalism. It may be just lack of understanding. It may be just bad reporting, and that can often be corrected. And often that happens in life situations when you're still trying to make sense of what's happening and you're reporting what you know. And then, you know, if there's a mistake, you correct it. It's not even opinion. I mean, very often, I mean, for fake news, for example, for Trump, fake news is anything that doesn't agree with him.
Right?
In the ideological sort of echo chambers we work on now, or we operate in now, most people think of any content which they don't agree with themselves, or if it doesn't match with their mental maps, automatically ye pakka fake hoga. This is fraud guys who are putting it. So in the sense that, I mean, by that definition, Arnab Goswami on one side or say Ravish on the other side would be fake news for depending on who's watching it, right? But that's not fake news. Opinion, having a certain opinion or having a certain slant or making genuine mistakes in reporting, not fake news. Fake news is something when you are deliberately put out something which you have falsified something and you know it's falsified. It's deliberately put out to cheat somebody, and you know that it's been manufactured.
Right.
Gen Z, your comment on that before
we
go on.
Yeah. So Nalin, I agree with you. So you know that is something that we take a lot of pain to explain to even our readers as well, which is why, as Geetika mentioned, globally there is among journalists and among fact checkers that we should not use the term fake news. Now, we can agree and disagree with that. I disagree partially as well with it, though I always feel that not using a term does not mean that you won't have the general disinterest or the members of the public not believing in news media, because that's a credibility problem. So that's another problem also set aside. But you're right. Actually, it's Donald Trump who weaponized this term fake news, because for him, every time CNN puts out something or watching something, he will say it's fake news. And that's how people also mistake that and they believe it here. As a policy at Boom, we are very careful when we use the term fake news. We don't use fake news, definitely not for publishers. Even the publishers whom we with very vehemently agree, and we probably may privately say that we don't even consider them journalists or journalism in itself. But just for the argument's sake, because they present themselves like that, we don't use the term fake news that loosely. So that's broadly what I would want to say.
Gen Z, before Geetika gets on with the next slides, there's a question which I think is relevant to ask us. There's a question which is coming saying, what is the difference, if any, between fake and false news?
Well, that's interesting. So I guess probably one could draw a nuance that, like the way you said it, right? That it could be wrong reporting where you can say that it is false, while fake is something which is outrightly fake, where suppose it's a manipulated media, the most common and well-known term today, thanks to Twitter, or some video which has been very interestingly edited and pushed out. We can use fake, maybe some video which has been superimposed, or an audio which has been superimposed, or an image which has been doctored. You can definitely use the term fake there, but otherwise you can say that the reporting is probably fraudulent, or not fraudulent, actually the reporting is probably not holding on to the highest qualities of journalism, and you can say that the claim being made is false. Use that term there. It's depending on how you want to probably use it. We are very careful when we use the word fake for anything.
Words matter, words always matter in journalism and in communications. The last thing on your slide, Geetika, is manipulated content. There's a question from Jashan, I think from Anmol Preet, who's actually asking to explain a bit more on what is manipulated content. And this is, of course, something which has been in the news last 2 weeks after Twitter put manipulated content on Sambit Patra's tweet, which is now a matter which is sub judice. It's being investigated by different agencies and so on. But manipulated content, that tag is often used by the big tech giants for things. And I think I'm familiar, so people often get confused. So if you can take that one up on manipulated content, explain that a bit more, Geetika, and then move on.
So for manipulated content, I'll give you a very basic example here. So let's say I take a screenshot of this Zoom call and I impose pictures of, let's say, PM Modi, Rahul Gandhi, and some other politicians. And I retain some of the original bit and some of the original shots, and I add those shots of the politicians. It's a end of the day. It is actually a genuine screenshot of a Zoom call that I'm part of, but I manipulated it by adding PM Modi's or Rahul Gandhi's image. So manipulated content is when you are manipulating a genuine imagery or a video. Let's say you see a lot of these images which have superimposed face phases of personalities, you know, or maybe they try to merge two pictures. Sometimes the video's audio has been removed to add some sort of a music or a background to it. All those kind of things are manipulated content. So this is a very basic level example, but roughly that's what it means. It's about manipulating. It's about, you know, I could be just making changes. I take a genuine image and I make changes to it. I could be adding elements to that, or I could be changing swipe. So that's roughly what manipulated content is.
Okay.
So 8 reasons why misinformation and disinformation is created and shared. Poor journalism, as Annalyn already mentioned. It's not poor journalism, but it just sometimes the versions are different. Sometimes we don't get the facts right. And I'm sure some you know, reporters have come across this kind of a situation in their career. Another reason is to parody. We are just there, out there to make fun, to prove or to punk a point. It could be about any issue, ideology. Passionate, I may be passionate about a certain ideology or a certain community or a certain issue. And that's why I'm driven to share everything that is related with that particular issue, community, etc., without thinking twice. Partisanship, maybe I'm just biased towards causes, community, etc. It's for money. Political influence, political parties use social media and this whole plank of misinformation and disinformation to discredit each other. So that is one there. And propaganda, maybe I'm trying to push somebody's agenda. We see all of this play out in front of us at all times nowadays, if you are an active social media user. So these are the 8 reasons of why misinformation and disinformation is created and shared. Now, going ahead, so a user or as a consumer of this information is, first of all, the first simple thing anybody can do is do a simple Google search. By the time anything reaches you, you know, in terms of maybe somebody sent you something on WhatsApp, or you saw a post on Facebook or Twitter with a certain context, it's already going viral. So in that case, I would suggest that do try to do a simple Google search with some of the keywords that are there in the post. Try to find out more about it. If it has happened, you know, if something has already been reported on it, you will find some genuine information. And if not, then try to go through multiple sources and see what is being published about that particular event across sources. So a lot of things are, you know, a lot of things get sorted at this basic level also, doing a simple Google search. We use Google search for all sorts of things through the day, you know, God knows what all kind of things we search. You know, we don't bother to do that when we are actually sharing information on social networks. We just blindly forward things because it's easier. Who's going to, you know, add one more step in this process by doing a search, verifying, and then putting it out?
So, Githika, if I can just interrupt there for a second. Sorry to interrupt. And there's a question which is coming, which is relevant. And this is a question for both you and Gen Z. Gen Z, if you could take it first. When you're talking about searching to find out how authentic something is or not, there's a question, see from whom immediately, but the question is, how do we know which resource can be trusted on the internet? It's a basic question. It's a 101 question. But very often, even people who are adept at looking at news sources often sometimes just skim through it and get it wrong. So any tips on that, Gen Z, from your end?
Nalin, that's a very good question, and it's a very relevant question. For example, suppose if we search for, is COVID-19 a bioweapon? 6 months back, if you would have asked me, all of us as fact checkers have done several stories where we present most relevant scientists in the world have discounted that and have said that it is not true. That it does seem to be a natural phenomenon, and it was definitely not a bioweapon. In the last 1 month, things have changed because the US government themselves have gone and, you know, set up an inquiry. What I would suggest
actually, if you had said it was a bioweapon, it would have been tagged as fake news by Facebook.
And I agree.
Only now they've said, okay, now it's okay to report on that.
No, now I think they're going a bit easy on it, but you know, they're still very, but the point is that I was giving the most extreme example. Most real life problems are not so extreme, you know. If you the basic thing that you need to do is, see, if you get an image on your WhatsApp or probably anywhere, like Geetika said, this Google reverse image search is the simplest of, you know, a tool that you can learn. This has been the base from where organizations like Boom have started. The first story that we would have done is through Google reverse image search. And then we graduated to more evolved and more, complex currently using. But otherwise, see, all of us are reading, right? We are reading. So we know that, okay, some may say that I find stuff on Times of India very relevant and credible. Some may say The Hindu, or some may say The Express. I think as evolved readers, we should not be leaving all things that we need to understand, which is credible or not, to Google. Because that's, you know, that's not something that would suggest that we are intelligent at all. You know, that's where God has given us intelligence and whatever ideology you believe in, and you know, how you believe that in, you know, maths is something which is innate in you, which is why we need to go back and see through our experience what are the sources where we believe. Now, there may be cases where even your most credible publication, you may end up putting out something which you may later find is not true. But that, I think, you can resolve by going to government sources, wherever. Like, you know, for example, for COVID, at the end of the day, whether we agree with whatever side of the divide we are on, whether the government is right or not, we still have to rely on certain scientific institutions. We have to rely on WHO,
Sukhmanpreet Kaur is actually saying, how do we know that Google is always right? Exactly what you're saying. Like, you know, how do you
ascertain? We don't know. Definitely, we don't know. That's exactly the point that I'm making, that you cannot trust Google. See, what is Google at the end of the day? Google is just curating various sources and throwing it at you. So it's your job to figure out, you know, what is the most credible. And the other thing is that we always say, look at the provenance, look at the source of the info. Are there quotes in the story? Are they, if suppose a newspaper organization is putting every information based on sources, then please take it with a pinch of salt. How much ever credible they may be. If there is an official quoted in it, or if there is a primary source which has been quoted in it, please, you know, at least trust that and look and believe it till the time you see some other source. The other final point that I would like to make is that, you know, the one major problem of social media and the fact that we are on social media all the time is because we are stuck in an echo chamber, right? Or filter bubbles, as we call it. Please be open to change. If today you believe in something and tomorrow there is a better evidence which shows that that is not true, please be open to changing your mind rather than holding on to it and saying, sometime back, I'm going to hold on to it. I think that is probably a better way to constantly evolve over some of the topics that are very controversial.
Yeah. Geetika, back to you on the reverse image search.
So the next thing, as Jensi already mentioned, is Google reverse image search. Like google.com is the search engine for text, for everything actually, but there is a dedicated search engine for images. It's called images.google.com, where you can actually go and search for images. Now, what exactly is Google? Basically, let's say I have a picture of a mountain and I do not know what mountain is that. I may try my luck and go to images.google.com, upload that image, and then try to find out information about that particular photo. So I'm doing the search in a reverse order, right? I do not know what it is, and I go to a search engine asking, tell me what it is. So that is what Google reverse image search is. It's the basis of fact-checking and verifying information. A lot of it is, though, you will end up using Google reverse image search no matter what. That is where it all starts. So how do you do reverse image search? Well, go to images.google.com. You have an option to upload an image. You have an option to paste the image URL, and then you can search it. I'll show you, but let me just quickly take you through the slides and then I can give you one or two examples as well. So what is it? Why is it that we are doing reverse image search to begin with? Now, first of all, the image is old and it has appeared previously on the web. When you search, when you will do a reverse image search with a photo, it will show you all the places or all the websites and links where that particular picture has been used. The second thing it will tell you is that in what context that image has been used. That is very important to know, because what we are trying to actually verify here is how genuine that image is, and plus how genuine that context that with which it's being shared. So it will tell you appeared on the internet and in what context it has been published. But again, that may just not be enough to begin with. So we'll have to find patient zero, that is the original source of that photo. Now, sometimes it could be newspapers, it could be agencies, it could be bloggers, it could be anyone who creates images and uploads on the web. So we have to keep our options open. And these are the three things, what reverse image search. Now, another thing is something which is very basic, which is already inbuilt in your Chrome browsers, is whenever you, if you, let's say you want to do an image search directly from a web page, just right click on the image and you will get an option called search Google with this image. So in that case, it will directly open the search page for that particular image. So you don't even have to do a search. Then this is another very interesting and a helpful plugin that you can use. It's called the Revi Reverse Image Search. Now, Google is not the only search engine available to us, right? So there are other search engines which you can use. So when you install this browser plugin, you can go to the Chrome Web Store and add it to your browser. When you right click, it will give you an option to do a reverse image search with various other kinds of search engines. Like Baidu is the Chinese one, Yandex is the Russian, Tenai is an alternative for images.google.com. So it gives you an option to search across search engines through one plugin. Now, this is Tenai, which is a reverse image search engine only for images. Again, it's more like images.google.com. But of course, Google is a wider universe compared to this, but this is another good option that's used for verifying photos. So quickly, I'll just show you some example of how actually fake reverse image search works. So let's say I'm going to take, okay, this is, so this is more, this example, I'm sorry. So this is an example of, these were the pictures that actually went viral in July 2020 or 19, I think. So these were being shared saying that these are the first set of pictures of Earth sent by Chandrayaan 2. Now, how do I do a reverse image search? Now, because it's on a slide, I'm just going to take a grab of this image. I will go to images.google.com. I'll upload this image.
We can get it.
So I will go and upload this image. And it will start searching, it will start doing a reverse image search. Now, what you see here is possible related search is the keywords that have got attached to this particular image over a period of time, because it has been published in a certain context. It will keep changing, it's saying Chennai, because it has already been fact checked, and a lot of places are using these keywords within their articles, and that's why these tags have been attached to this particular photo. So now what do I have to do is, of course, I'm not going to click on any of the links that are fact checked articles. So I'll just quickly go through the links which don't talk about about these images, that these are actually from Chandrayaan. So I go back in the in the search results further. And on the second page, I see this article saying, it talks about this picture, but in a very different context. It talks about that it's actually an erupting volcano. So this is behind a paywall. And on actually, this is the original article where these images were first published. And you got to know that these are basically pictures of a volcano eruption somewhere in so this is not actual Chandrayaan images that Earth images taken by Chandrayaan. I'll quickly do another example. So this is like the basic.
If I can just interrupt there for a second. I think that's very useful. And that's, it really sets the context on some of the nuts and bolts of how you go about checking and having greater digital literacy, if you like, to become a more informed reader of things. We are getting a lot of questions around. Did you want to show one example and then we open it up, or should we just move on?
It's up to you. I'm open. I can quickly show one more example and then we can move on.
Okay, so
this is another image that went viral with a very different context, saying that some farmer is being beaten up by the police for not paying his loans. But this is a genuine image. I'll just try to do a simple Google search again, reverse image search, and see what do I get. So I again go back to my images.google.com, upload this particular image. And do a search, and it will tell me, it should tell me if this is actual image or not. Now again, for some reason, religion is attached to it. So this is one image, this is one link, which is actually talking this particular image, but in a very different context. So I click on it and it tells that it's actually about, Rajkot police resorting to public shaming. And this is one of the criminals who has been accused of rape, I think. And he's being publicly shamed and publicly punished for his crimes. So this was the original contest.
It's
a thief or, okay, wait. The captions are off. It's an old story. So this is how you do. This is like a very basic thing to do when it comes to reverse image search. You might have to do multiple times. I'm just doing it once and I am getting my hits. But sometimes you might have to do it at multiple levels. You might have to do a double reverse image search to find the right context. You might have to go deeper into the search results to find the, right context. But this is the basic, or you can do either from a laptop or a mobile phone and try to help fight this menace of fake news.
I think that's really helpful, Gitika. And like you said, this is the basic first level of checking that one does. But let me bring you in, Jensi, on this. I mean, you've been doing this for a very long time now. You run a new fact-checking newsroom that works in India. You also do this in Bangladesh. You also do this in Myanmar. Your experience is very widespread. What are the two or three key things that you notice and the kind of trends that you notice when you encounter stuff like this, which is either misinformation or disinformation or false content?
You know, Nalin, there was a time when nearly about 3 years back when we started on this journey, when there were not enough there were no fact checkers, and the mainstream media largely never touched anything which was on social media. So at that point of time, we noticed a very clear trend then that whatever we used to get on WhatsApp, we usually got probably 3 or 4 days later on Facebook and Twitter and everywhere else. Mm. Today, it's get something on WhatsApp, and we run two helplines that we've been running over the last two and a half years. The moment we get it on WhatsApp, so the first thing that I always tell my team is that, have you checked it on Facebook or Twitter? And it's made our job easy because now we know the virality of it. Earlier on WhatsApp, we could never know how viral it is unless some 10 people send it to us, right? Today, the moment it comes onto our WhatsApp helpline, we just have to pick the text, go and search it on Facebook or Twitter, and we will get like the string of posts that we will witness. Secondly, what we've seen is usually anything which is communal spreads like wildfire. Yes, we've also seen the same with COVID, because that's again a health phenomenon which over the last 1.5 years we've seen. But otherwise, communal misinformation, it's just the current state of, you know, where we are as a society, as a country, or probably any society around the world. That, you know, we are so polarized, and that's why probably moment you get something and you see, okay, probably it is either connected to your faith or your ideology, immediately you are in a hurry to forward or to push it out. But that's what we always tell people. Please don't use your WhatsApp as a mechanism to spread news, because that's not why WhatsApp was initially founded, right? It's basically for one-to-one communication and for peer-to-peer communication. You know, please use it for that. Don't do mass forwardings. And that's why I always feel that one good step that WhatsApp took of limiting forwards to 5 people, we can counter that and say that, you know, those who are in the fake news business can run and do it through various algos and through, you know, having multiple numbers. But otherwise, I think that limiting it to 5 people has really made a big difference.
There's a question which is coming in, Geetika, on, you know, you showed the Google reverse image tool and the other tools like that. There's a question, is there a tool to search on for audio clips?
To search only for audio clips. I'm sure Gen Z can elaborate on that as well. Because I don't think so there is any such tool as such, because audios are very easy to manipulate that way. And even for videos, there is no dedicated one tool. We still have to take screen grabs and do a reverse image search with that. I'm actually not into active fact checking, so maybe Gen Z would be the right person to
answer. Gen Z, if I can add to that, and to that question, and also there's another linked question which Julius has asked. So maybe you could take both of them together. What if images, when it comes to images, what if such images weren't previously engaged in Google? In case Google has no information about an image and you're trying to fact check. So how do you deal with that? And then how do you deal with fake audio?
Both very good practical questions. And whoever is asking, they are thinking like a fact checker already. So as far as audio is concerned, it's one of, you know, the best of facts area. And this we've seen over and over again over the last 2 years, where someone will say, oh, Pakistan Zindabad slogan is being shouted, or some other slogan, which is like, you know, the very typical anti-national kind of allegations that are made. What we often do is, there is one tool called Audacity, where you can go and check the waves of the audio and can figure out if there is any slicing that has been done. But it's very difficult, Nalin. Which is why, you know, we depend on video editors, you know, your typical television video editors, Nalin, that you are aware of, with whom we worked in the past. They are pretty good in spotting if there is a patching of audio. But, you know, even there you can fail if, you know, the audio has been layered in a manner in which you cannot catch it. But what we usually do is that we try and look, okay, there's a wire media for that. What we do is we find out where this video has been shot or where this audio has been shot. We call people, like, you know, we have to literally make, you know, a lot of calls, call people and find out if anyone has shot an original video there and tell them to send you the original video. We've done frame by frame comparison of someone probably saying that, okay, at this protest march, there was this audio or this chant that was made. Then we call up people who were present their version of the video which they shot, and we try to see if we can match both by video and audio frame, and then we check whether that it's the same or not. And invariably, in many cases, we have found that someone had layered the audio over it. So that's one way that you can find out. As far as the second question about what if it's an original image which someone has doctored and put it out and you're not able to figure out, that's a very tough question. Again, there, that is where you'll have to use classical forms of journalism. You know, find out where this image has originated from. What is the location? Many images have very telltale signs. You know, and this is what I think Geetika might be planning to share that as well. There are very clear geolocation tags, right? For example, there might be a bus which is passing from behind, and you will go and look at the number plates. I cannot tell you the number of stories where number plates have saved our lives. because we looked at the number plates, and these are number plates that you may not normally observe in an image. Or there was once we did a story where someone had claimed something about Kerala, and we found out in a very small we Google searched and we went on searching for that image or where that shop is. Now it happened that, you know, that shop actually was a very common name, which were in practically every city. Then we found out where it is. We called up that shopkeeper. We asked him whether this incident happened there or not. And he told us probably what had happened at that point.
Jensi, that's a great example. If I can share a similar example. And we were running the fact check desk at the Times of India. There was you might remember this, because I think Boom Live also might have done a story on this around that time. This is, I think, 2 years back. There was a video circulating around on WhatsApp about alleged Rohingya Muslims going on a rampage in Bhopal or in Indore, one of the big cities in Madhya Pradesh. And there was a lot of uproar on social media about it. So we wanted to fact check whether this is true or not. So one of the things that was a giveaway in that video was exactly the number plate and others. But then we did good old-fashioned journalism. You know, we called the SP in that area. We figured out where this area is from, and we called that guy and said, look, and the police then said on the record, this is absolutely false. There is no such record of anything like this happening here. Then we called people in that locality. So basically, we use a multiple number of sources. We use the reverse image searches. We looked at all of the kind of things that you said. And then we called people on the ground to check. And then we were absolutely sure that this is a video from somewhere else. It's not from here.
Yeah, there's no one way to do it. You have to use, I mean, the number of ways we have tried and tested and, you know, done it. Like, you know, it's like a Bible in our journal, in our newsroom, you know, where we keep on looking back at older stories that we have done and say, okay, what did we do in these kind of cases? And then we go back and use the same techniques, you know. So
there's a question from Nishang Gulati, and this is a very relevant question in times like today, where newsrooms or everybody wants first to post to publish content and capitalize on the first mover advantage. How can you do fact checks quickly?
Exactly what my frustration is often, you know. See, we are competing at the end of the day for traffic with many people. And one might argue that, okay, fact checkers should not be bothered about traffic and all of that. Those are very nice things to say in theory. In real life and practical life, that's not the case at all. You know, as an editor, I know how much stress I take just because, you know, something has gone viral and probably a mainstream media publication would have run something. And the difference between them and our newsroom is very critical. And the critical difference is that wherever you have newsrooms where they are saying that they want content writers, they will not be practicing journalism. And I'm very vehemently saying this. And I know I've said this in the past in LinkedIn and various other places, and people have really gone after me for this. But let me make that on anything that people do. What I'm trying to say is that the moment you start saying that your journalists are content writers, then you are not teaching them the basics of journalism. While when a video or an image comes to my newsroom, the first thing that we tell people to check is, do we know the original source? Can we speak to the original person who's tagged in that video or who's speaking in that video to find out what it is? Unless 100% we are sure that we have all the facts in place, we will not write the story. So fact checkers will always be one step behind from mainstream media publishers who probably may not have that much stress of checking everything. And, you know, that's an occupational hazard and you can't do much about it. But I think we are getting better and we are turning around stories much more faster than what we were doing 2 years back.
Okay, now here's another very interesting question. And Githika, if I can ask you to take this. This is a slightly broader question. Is it sometimes okay to manipulate the viewers on social media? Maybe if you're promoting a brand.
That's interesting.
Manipulation is not going to take you far, I'll be honest. You know, it's okay, like, you know, you will gain a certain kind of audience and that will become your echo chamber over a period of time where you will not be able to see the other side of things. It might be like what I would love to know what is the extent of manipulation we are talking about here, you know. Sometimes if you're just making a very harmless meme or something, then that's okay. But if you are going to, you know, manipulate an imagery or a video and then just start sharing it with a completely different context, then it actually becomes problematic. You will become, you know, your audience over a period of time will realize that you are manipulating them at, you know, on everyday basis, and they will not trust you in long term. That is,
yeah, I think also, I think this is a question that goes to the heart of, you know, so many of the a very slippery dividing line between different forms of content, right? I mean, after all, as news creators or as news advertisers are trying to convince people to buy their product. So I mean, it goes back to the definitional issues that we had at the beginning. You know, what is false, what is fake, what is, you know, an argument, and what crosses that line? And this question really, I think, goes to the heart of that agency.
Like, how, you know, we have seen examples of how brands are being called out for sponsoring shows where they talk about all these, you know, where they are actually manipulating viewers in, you know, in various ways. It's not just imageries, it's actually a mind game there. So it's not going to help you at all. And for a brand, it's very important to know that you cannot let that trust go away, or you cannot let that trust erode over a period of time for catching some eyeballs at some particular time. That's not going to work. The mistrust that will come between you and your audience, that is, you will not be able to fill that. People will not trust you. People will not come back to you. And sometimes it's harmless, but sometimes if it actually becomes too serious, then it's like, you know, you are not, nobody's going to come and save your ass in that way.
So let me ask a question on this, Gitika. There's a question from Annette, I think, which says, what about when a variety show is edited? I'm just reading out the question. What about when a variety show is edited and broadcast in a way that shows a person in a bad way, done for high views and DRP? Can this be called a fake video, or is it a different thing?
It's not a fake video. It's again manipulation of genuine content. You are being a selective, you are selectively choosing information, and you are presenting it with a very false context. So again, here it is, it's a case of manipulation and false context. So not false, I would say, but as you are trying to manipulate somebody's image by just editing certain parts and putting them in a very different light. This has happened many times. It happens with celebrities many times, where their quotes are taken out of context and they are circulated on social media saying, okay, this is what they are saying. It happens a lot with politicians also. And then there would always be somebody, you know, you will find a fuller version of that quote, or maybe some media has already reported that, you know, a longer version of it. You will find some longer video of it. So that is, you'll ultimately, it will find, the truth will find you, but you'll have to, you know, but you cannot just take everything on the face value. This is not fake per se, like, you know, fake, but it is manipulation of content.
Nalin, can I take one question from the audience? Please. Here? How we can know a fake account at any social media site? My favorite topic, you know. So, you know, this is something that I often say that, the blue ticks have been misused. So you'll find a lot of IT cell, political IT cells being given this blue tick. But normally, we know that, okay, they are from a particular political party, or they're genuine people, at least on social media. They're not impersonating someone. So that's one way, you know, you can look at whether the person has a blue tick or not. Secondly, if you observe, and I think many of the students here would have observed, people like Ratan Tata, Sundar Pichai, you'll often find quotes attributed to them, which are running on Twitter. And many of these are handles with their name. So please go and check on their bio if there is a parody mentioned there or not, because Twitter insists that if you're using the name of, for your handle for probably of some publicly known person, you need to be very clear that it is not an official account. Either you put an unofficial account, or you say it's a fan account, or you say it's a parody account or a satire account. So that is one other indicator for you. The other thing is, I often say this, and I'm only saying this from my intuition and anecdotal evidence, many accounts behind it. Now, please tell me if you want to make your account like a Nalin or a Jensi or a Gitika, we are not going to put Nalin Mehta 01245678. You know, you'll never do it. That is classical sign of being a bot account, you know, either a bot account or someone who's gone and created a lot of handles and, you know, use someone else's image and pushing out, you know, complete drivel on social media. So these are some of the things that you can definitely use and check whether, you know, and all of us look at the history.
Jensi, two questions on the blue ticks which you mentioned. And blue ticks have been in the news a lot in the last couple of weeks. There are two questions here. The first is, which says that just 1 second. Getting a blue tick is easy nowadays. Even I can get a blue tick. And somebody else says, well, we can also get for verification. And I think that's a deeper question as well, that look, very often people who have blue ticks have false information, right? Especially if they're politicians.
Yeah.
The second question is, I recently came across a blue tick account on Insta and they had 10,000 followers, but had less than 100 likes on every post. Can we say they probably bought their followers?
You know, it is quite possible, because I do know that some people who claim that they are digital media or social media strategists, that they do promise companies and they do promise influencers that they will manage to get them verified ticks. I don't know. If I ask Facebook or Instagram about this, they will definitely say no. In fact, Twitter, I saw a lot of people, a lot of genuine journalists complaining about that they had applied for the verified blue tick and they applied and did not get it. So I'm sure that there is something going on which is wrong. We haven't been able to put our finger on it. The other thing about the fact that despite having 10,000 followers, getting 100 likes, that may also be a genuine case, right? Someone must have had a lot of followers, would have got a blue tick, but the content is just not interesting enough for people to go and engage.
Yeah.
So that I think we should be able to identify very easily.
Yeah.
And on Instagram, you can actually apply for even if you have a smaller account, you can apply for a verification tag. So that's not I don't think so. Followers, of course, like he has 10,000 followers, which is good enough for him to get a blue tick. Verification process there also. So no, there are just certain benchmarks that you have to fulfill and you can get a blue tick. Same case with now with Twitter, that they have reopened verifications. It's actually not very easy to get one now. They are looking for really genuine information. And, you know, like for a journalist, you need to have active bylines in last 6 months. Even for influencers or politicians, etc., the benchmarks or the rules that they have set up for verification is very stringent. I'm glad that has happened, because earlier, everybody was, you know, all sorts of people were getting blue ticks and they were actually saying a lot of rubbish on these social networks, especially on Twitter, and, you know, inciting hate and what violence, and, you know, are talking derogatory about people. And so, but now the process has been really streamlined after, I think it is they suspended it for quite some time because of the white supremacist in the US, that whole scam that, not scam, but the whole incident that happened a year ago. Now the process is pretty strict, I would say.
Thanks for that, Geetika. I think there are lots of questions, like you said, around the blue tick verification process as well. I mean, there's a question here, Jashanpreet is asking, well, sometimes people having 100,000 followers can't get a blue tick, but people having 10 to 15,000 get verified. Some of them are apprehensions, some of them are questions, some of them are issues of Twitter itself having its applying different standards to different people. So I guess it's a mixed bag of both. Julius Kudu is in Dhruv Rathi with 1.1 million followers hasn't got a blue tick. Gen Z, quick response on that.
I have no idea why Dhruv Rathi does not have a blue tick, but it could see. Also, the point is that the reason why blue ticks were given is because many genuine people in public life were being impersonated, and it was their way of saying that, okay, we know this person and this person's identity has been checked by us. And if you want to believe anything that the person is saying and publicly saying, then please go to their verified. I don't know about Dhruv Rathi specifically in his case, but I don't think Dhruv Rathi requires a blue tick. I mean, he has a large following either way. You know?
So, Gen Z, Geetika, I have one last question for you, and we've run out of time. So, very quickly, I was just very curious personally to know, Gen Z and Geetika, how did you get involved in working on fake news?
Well,
how did your journey start on this?
Well, in my case, in 2016, I was in a job transition from Business Standard. I was the editor of the web division, and the team was moving to Delhi. I being a pro, lived all my life in the city, did not want to move. So, you know, Govind, our founder, called me and said, you know, that why don't you join me? Because, but at that time, we had no idea that what we were going to do. So he said, there is a site called Boom that I run, but, you know, it does not have an editor. Why don't you come? So I came in and I joined with one extra person on the team. So that's where our journey at Boom started. So we, interestingly, on the day when I joined, that was November 8, 2016, was the day when Donald Trump came to power in the US, and another historical event happened, that is demonetization was announced. So, you know, I started my day with a bang, with one person in the team. And all that we did for the next 1.5 months were only fact-checking. And fact-checking, not the way we know about it. What we were doing is we were looking at public statements being made by government and ministers defending demonetization. And we were going and looking at the numbers. And we were putting out stories like that. It's only in the month of March or April, and I'll tell you how our journey in fake news busting started. It was a video of a aircraft, of a fire incident. Video went viral, and this came to us, and we were looking at it. And I said, okay, but I know people in Jet Airways. I picked up the phone and I spoke to them, and I said, you know, this video is going viral. So, you know, the person who I know there, she told me, no, Gen Z, that's not true. That's actually a fire drill that we did a week back. Mm. So that video must be going viral. And we immediately wrote that story, and that story got a lot of hits. Mm. So that is the first story. It started with a Jet Airways story at Boom, and that's how we started. And then we had realized that there is a serious problem, which mainstream media was not addressing at all. But that is the space that we could have gotten because we were still trying to figure out what to do.
Yeah. Thanks for that, Gen Z. Githika, your stint as a teaching fellow working with the Google News Lab?
So I think, for me, it started in 2018 when I joined the bootcamp at Google for fact-checking training. I was actually surprised at how simple the tools are, but the use case is so interesting and how they can actually solve very complex information issues here. And I've never faced these kind of problems of, you know, fake news or misinformation, disinformation. And I was like, and of course, when you are in a newsroom, or when you are on the news floor all the time, you don't get a chance to step out and upskill yourself. So actually, that's how my journey began with training with that particular boot camp. And the Google News Fellowship also was something that actually helped me hone some of my skills. And the fact-checking training was a big part of my trainings. Everywhere we used to go, I used to go for training. The most interactive and the most vibrant sessions were these, because everybody had some view or the other on fake news. And the best part is that some of these tools are very simple for everyone to use. It's not just about that you need to be very tech savvy. You need to have a lot of knowledge about computers or internet in general. But you can, if you are friendly with the machine, with the technology, you can. And then also the point is that the housekeeping starts with your own WhatsApp groups, right? So, be it your family or be your friends or school friends, college friend groups, etc. Everywhere people are sharing all sorts of things. So I have become that one person in my groups where I keep sending out, fake news alerts every time somebody shares something. And then they actually make notice of it. Now I've reached a point where people actually send me, can you check if this is right or wrong? As he's making some change somewhere. My training experience was definitely the highlight. Those 12 months, I was literally, talking about fact-checking to so many people coming from so different backgrounds, media students. For media students, it was more about that it can be a career opportunity. It's an upcoming beat within journalism. So do not get disheartened if you do not get reporting or editing. You can look at this as an option as well. And for journalists, it was more about, arre, ye to hume pata hi nahi tha, itna asaan hai karna. And especially in regional newsrooms. So that enlightening, and I also learned few things. People had their own ways of doing fact checking, like, you know, traditional reporters or, you know, reporters from traditional media, they have their own network of, you know, they'll just follow up and try to verify things. I think, and if everything fails, you have to make those calls.
Thanks so much. We'll have to wrap it up now. We're out of time. Thank you so much, Githika and Gen Z. I think we've been doing these series of conversations over the last 3 days. This has really been a highlight of that. I think we've been very fortunate to get both of you on this conversation. I certainly enjoyed this and the kind of comments we've got. It's been one of the most exciting sessions we've done. Thank you so much for spending your time and for sharing your insights on this. I'm very grateful to you both, Geetika and Gen Z. Thanks very much.
Thank you for having us.
Right.
Thanks, Geetika.
Bye.
Right.
Thank you.